32 years ago, Jim Cameron's Aliens was released, and it quickly became an action genre favourite for millions of viewers. It's still highly praised today by critics and audiences, and yet it was an action film with a female protagonist. A protagonist who starts off in a severely weakened and demotivated state, but by the end of the movie, she's blasting aliens to pieces with machine guns and using a robot exoskeleton to fight a giant queen alien. But unlike a lot of modern movies that try to push so-called strong female leads and end up meeting with huge amounts of criticism and disapproval, male viewers still love the movie Aliens. I've never heard a single male fan of this movie complain about Ripley being a woman who takes charge of a group primarily consisting of men and who kicks ass with guns. Men embrace the Ripley character more so than any other lead female character that I've ever encountered. So, as a man and fan of the movie Aliens and of the Ripley character in that film, I've gone through the movie and identified what I think are the reasons for the success of the Ripley character and story, and conveniently my thoughts rounded off to 10 key points. So here goes. Number 1, she leads men by positive example. Ripley is initially looked down on as a weak outsider by the Marines, including the female ones, but after taking charge of the APC and saving several of the Marines, she slips straight into leading them. She does this through the display of character traits that rapidly win their trust and respect. First of all, she shows courage and the willingness to take responsibility in the APC rescue. I remember the first time watching Aliens. I was about 14 years old, and that moment when she takes charge of the rescue and that pounding music kicks in, it was like, you go, girl.
Ripley, what the hell are you doing?
Then she leads by being the team member quickest to acknowledge the reality of their situation.
I ain't going back in
there. You can't help them. You can't. Right now they're being cocooned just like the others.
While others fall into denial.
This can't be happening, man. This isn't happening.
Then she leads by being the ideas gal.
What are we talking about this for?
I say we take off and nuke the entire site from orbit.
Fucking A.
Oh, hold on, 1 second. This installation has a substantial dollar value attached to it.
This operation is under military jurisdiction, and Hicks is next in chain of command. Am I right, Corporal?
Yeah.
And that's twice that she's defied inefficient authority. She also shows herself to be the best information gatherer and the most observant. This came in an early hint before the APC rescue.
Well, look where your team is. They're right under the primary heat exchangers.
So?
So, if they fire their weapons in there, won't they rupture the cooling system?
Oh. Yeah, she's absolutely right.
That basic piece of information was there on the display, and Gorman missed it. Then, even though Hicks is officially in charge, he's happy to share the leadership role with her because he recognises her intelligence and other personality strengths. She gives at least half the orders and comes up with at least half the ideas.
Now I want you to get on a terminal and call up some kind of floor plan file, do you understand? Construction blueprints, I don't care, anything that shows the layout of this place, are you listening?
Yeah.
And a last essential leadership component for any hero, she has a can-do attitude. In the face of bad news, she's the one who jumps forward immediately with determination to find solutions and get the job done.
Oh, we've got to get the other dropship from the Sulaco. I mean, there must be some way of bringing it down on remote.
How? The transmitter's on the APC. It's wasted.
Well, I don't care how, but we better think of something. We better think of a way.
Number 2, she has believable attributes. Many movies try to create inspiring female action leads, but fail because the characters and their actions aren't believable. Actually, it's common to male action leads today as well, so the example of Ripley can be learned from on both fronts. The most essential thing is Ripley doesn't have superhuman strength, dexterity, or precision. A lot of female action lead types aren't believable because they're seen beating up men who are obviously a lot physically stronger than themselves. That's a simple reality between the sexes that no amount of wishful distortion can change. Except maybe if there's a transsexual action hero, but somehow I don't think audiences would flock to that movie unless it was a really un-PC comedy. Not a bad idea, actually. I'd give it a watch. Having said that, Vasquez is pretty butch, so maybe it could actually work.
Vasquez,
have you ever been mistaken for a man?
No. Have you?
I mean, they do seem to have trans-organ face-huggers.
Looks like love at first sight to me. Oh, he likes you, Burke.
That common problem of exaggerated physical attribute problems aren't present in Ellen Ripley. She can be seen physically struggling with heavy guns, yet her use of these unfamiliar tools shows a strong sense of adaptability. Physical strength isn't the central trait of heroes anyway. If it were, then these Marines ought to be able to take on the hard-shelled aliens barehanded. No, resourcefulness is what determines the superior species, and in Ripley's case, it determines who makes the best soldier. Locked in a room with two facehuggers, the not-so-obvious, resourceful solution is to set off the fire alarms to bring help. Charging into an alien nest on your own to save a little girl, the not-so-obvious resourceful strategy is to tape your gun and flamethrower together to make a hybrid weapon. That's an essential trait for movie heroes, male and female. The hero should be able to come up with solutions that the audience wouldn't think of. And in a master genius scriptwriting stroke from Jim Cameron, if you're trapped in a spaceship with an alien, the not-so-obvious resourceful solution is to climb into an exoskeleton loader and punch the hell out of it. Number 3, she acknowledges the importance of masculinity. Okay, this is a short and simple point, but it's very important. There's a big irony in a lot of feminism and feminist heroes in movies. They tend to rate masculinism in men as some sort of inherently evil and undesirable trait. As often is the case, though, the subtleties of language reveal what's actually going on. The feminist desire for strong female leads is a subconscious admission from them that masculinism does have an important and useful role in society. It's just as important as feminism, actually. Ripley appropriately scoffs at the phony masculinism from the likes of Hudson, but through necessity, she ends up adopting marine traits in order to survive and to save others. Number 4, she doesn't play the victim. Ripley is subjected to unfair treatment at the outset of the film. Life, the universe, and the corporation are against her. And while she's clearly pissed off and feels hard done to, she doesn't blame her misfortunes on her gender. She doesn't try to claim that her flight officer license was revoked because she's a woman. She doesn't complain that she's got a crappy job because she's a woman. She can't even complain that she's an outsider among the Marines on account of being a woman, because some of them are women. The main pilot's a woman, and a woman initially leads the way into danger. And there's no complaint from any of these women that men are using microaggressions to dominate them. There's no sexual groping or uninvited flirting from the Marines toward Ripley. No fear of rape from her, even though she was slightly offended at their dumb sex talk at the dinner table.
It's a rescue mission. You'll love it. There's some juicy colonist daughters we have to rescue from their virginity.
Favorite duty. Dumbass colonists.
It was a bit below the belt, though. He didn't specify an age for the daughters. There is something weird going on sexually, though. This guy, who is very suspiciously called Spunkmeyer, discovers one of the Marines has been jerking off in the dropship again. And did you ever notice the strange detail when the company man Burke sits on Ripley's bed and fondles what I think is a piece of her clothing, which she immediately pulls away from him?
Stop your grinning and drop your linen. Found him.
Number 5. She looks natural. I always find it funny when female protagonists are presented as being strong and resistant to the sexual advances of evil men, yet those female leads are sexually alluring in their appearance. It's like the protagonist wants to be intensely desired, yet have the power to sexually reject. Often this sexual allure comes in the form of a voluptuous, tanned physique, or even worse, the female lead may be played by an actual supermodel. Enter pasty-skinned, small-breasted, lanky, yet casually good-looking Ripley. Her curly hair doesn't bounce about in slow motion like she's in a shampoo commercial, her breasts don't bounce around as she runs, and she wears no makeup. She isn't sexually objectified by others, and she doesn't sexually objectify herself. Number 6, and this is just a continuation of the last point really, she dresses practically. No low-cut tops, no short skirts, no sexually alluring colours, no jewellery, no look at me, aren't I a rebel tattoos, and no fighting in high heels. Enough said. Number 7, she embraces motherhood. Ironically, Ripley's earliest instance of taking leadership of the team is the moment when they encounter a lost little girl. Motherhood instinct kicks in. The desire to protect and nurture children, which is a trait that should be pushed a lot more in movies as an admirable trait for men and women. And I'm not talking about the, ooh, look, the hero saved the kid by killing all the bad guys, only to then hand the kid to someone else to do all the laborious and relentless day-to-day work of raising that child. That's where the real hard work is. Good parenting by either sex is a heroic trait of the feminist nature.
Easy, easy. It's gonna be okay. It's all right, you're gonna be okay. Shh, 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 shh. Easy.
Mommy.
Oh, God.
Aliens does the rare thing of showing this parenthood instinct not just in a big guns blazing rescue the kid mission, but Ripley provides to the little girl, Newt, empathy.
And who is this?
Casey.
Hello, Casey.
Security.
And you see that camera right up there? I can see you right through that camera all the time to see if you're safe.
Education.
My mommy always said there were no monsters, no real ones, but there are.
Yes, there are, aren't there?
Why do they tell little kids that?
Most of the time it's true.
Compliments.
Oh, I don't know how you managed to stay alive, but you're one brave kid, Rebecca. Hard to believe there's a little girl under all this. Pretty one, too.
And the patience that is alien to most of the marine characters around here.
You don't talk much, do you?
Now look, Rebecca, you have to try and help.
Give it a rest, why don't you?
Ripley washes her, feeds her, cuddles and kisses her, and tucks her into bed twice. The first instance is a very powerful and emotional scene that sets up the motive for her rescuing Newt at the end of the movie.
I'm not going to leave you, Newt. I mean that. That's a promise.
You promise?
I cross my heart.
And hope to die.
And hope to die.
And that brings me on to my favourite scene of the whole movie, by the way. And in my opinion, it's the best female empowerment scene ever filmed. Ripley in the elevator heading down into the depths of hell as she gears up for combat, accompanied by an adrenaline-surging military drum score. Step aside Clint Eastwood, Ripley's become an unstoppable Rambo motivated by motherly compassion. Actually, if you ever need a jolt of instant confidence, say if you've got a job interview or something and you're a bit nervous, just play that piece of elevator music in your mind right before you go in. Oh, and my second favourite female empowerment scene ever is Ripley, again motivated by parental compassion.
Get away from her, you bitch!
Number 8. She appreciates a decent man. Thankfully, the film doesn't overdo this, but Ripley develops a clear love interest in Hicks.
Here, I want you to put this on.
What's it for?
It's a locator.
Thanks.
Doesn't mean we're engaged or anything. Alright, what's next?
Given the dangerous scenario, it would be totally inappropriate to have Hicks and Ripley get it on during the story, but he does let her play with his piece. Hicks was always the Marine leader in waiting. Here he sits in the highest position of the group. He provides a little traditional male support to Ripley by giving her the locator, which she puts on Newt. He's the only one of the Marines who shows proper concern for her well-being.
Are you all right? How long's it been since you got any sleep?
And she doesn't get paranoid and reject him on account of his, oh my god, microaggressions. And he's the only male who shows an inclination toward fatherhood.
Got 15 of these M40 grenades. Don't touch that. Dangerous, honey.
There's even a handful of shots where he, Ripley, and Newt are shown huddled together like an unofficial family. Number 9. She doesn't lecture endlessly about her moral superiority. Ripley doesn't talk about her strong female identity, she lives it. And even though she has opportunities to, she doesn't engage in the nagging brand of chastising others for their failings.
Look, Ripley, I just...
Forget it. Excuse me.
Sure, she does severely chastise Burke, and with very good reason. She's physically aggressive to him, but it's believable because she's tall and he's quite puny and a pen pusher, so that works fine. And her concern for the colonists was interestingly framed as a concern for families, not individuals.
How many are there? How many colonists?
I don't know, 60, maybe 70 families. Do you mind?
Families.
That means Burke is responsible for a lot of kids dying. And given that he caused this whole scenario, he must be responsible as well for the only two black characters dying at the start of the very first fight. He must be a racist. Just as important, as well as Ripley not running about singing her own praises or slating everyone else, Cameron doesn't have other characters gushing in admiration for her surprise leadership strengths. Bishop even plays down her monumental achievements.
Not bad for a human.
And last point, number 10, she fights corruption and danger, not men. Ripley's conflict with the boardroom members includes cold pen pusher women as well as men. She even argues with one of them.
Did IQs just drop sharply while I was away?
And my God, that stupid assumption by feminists that if we fill all the boardrooms with women, then companies will act more compassionately. No, the problem with boardroom pen pusher types is not that they're mostly men, it's because they're a different psychological breed. If you took a handful of average men off the street and put them in charge of corporate boardrooms, you'd get very different results than you do with the kinds of men who seek those positions as long-term career options. And I'm not talking about business operational knowledge, I'm talking about morality. At the same time, the type of women who are attracted to boardroom pen pusher roles aren't the same as average women on the street. They don't typically have the same compassionate drives as average people. A lot of them are really cold, manipulative liar types, men or women. They're a self-selecting breed in that respect, because boat-rocking moralists, male or female, aren't welcome among boardroom ranks. We could take Ripley's conflicts with Burke as a representation of female compassion versus male corporate mentality if it weren't for the women in this boardroom scene at the start, or the presence of her love interest, Hicks. So I don't see a lot of mileage in that interpretation. However, Ripley is very hostile to the android Bishop on account of her symbolic rape trauma with the android Ash in the first movie. Eventually, she learns to let go of her fear and hate of mandroids as she realises that androids, they're not all the same. They're not all the sleazy, arse-grabbing, cat-calling, cock-inserting enemy.
Bishop, you did okay.
I did.
Oh, yeah.
The option was there to script Bishop as a woman, by the way, and that would have made quite a different dynamic in the movie, being that gender appearances would not affect the underlying abilities of an android. And by that I mean physical strength, not intellect. And therein lies a great truth. The only way to create universal equality of the sexes is to eliminate the sexes so that we're all exactly the same under the outer flesh appearances. Maybe that's what today's over-the-top promotion of transgenderism is subconsciously all about. The elimination of genders. So, there you go, 10 reasons why Aliens is the best feminism movie ever made. Not bad for a woman.
Why don't you put her in charge?
You better just start dealing with it, Hudson.
And ironically, the movie is written and directed by a man. The more hateful feminists should be forced at gunpoint to watch Aliens until its valuable lessons sink in. Thankfully though, not all feminists hate men. You've been listening to Rob Ager. I've got tons of other videos on movies mostly, but also on video games and psychology and other stuff. Subscribe if you haven't already, but if you want access to my huge backlog of offline material, plus some big articles, then visit my website, collativelearning.com. And don't forget, folks, offense is in the eye of the beholder.
Check it out. I am the ultimate badass.
Yes, sir.
State of the badass art. You do not want to fuck with me. Check it out.